My name is Giselle. I'm the nurse practitioner for Dr. Petrossian here at the Pacific Movement Disorder Center. It is Everything Parkinson. Today is actually our 1 year anniversary. Dr. Diaz was our very first speaker in our Everything Parkinson webinar series. And to celebrate our 1 year, we have our director, Dr. Petrossian, today with another webinar rich in information. This time we're going to be talking about genetics, which I think is one area where we all have probably a lot of questions regarding. Before we start the webinar, I just want to remind everyone that for the past webinars video, it is already up in our website at Pacific Neuroscience Institute website. You can click on the webinar videos if you want to review some of those videos. Okay, without further ado, our fearless director, Dr. Melita Petrossian.
Thank you, Giselle. I just wanted to, to add on to what you said with that. An easy way to remember our website is pacificneuro.org. And then you'll have to go through, I think, resources and webinars. It's sort of under some dropdowns. Okay, so today I'm going to put on yet another hat and pretend to be a geneticist for the day. Really, I just wanted to, because I get so many questions about this, I wanted to answer things as questions have come up to me. But really, it's going to be a very high level conversation today. I'm not necessarily going to get into extreme nitty gritty, but I want people to sort of have a general sense of kind of how things have evolved. And I should say that this is really an evolving field. So if you are watching this webinar on our website and it's 2024, probably some amount of it has changed by now. So I do want to give everybody a starting point, which is, you know, sort of the basics of genetics. So a gene is sort of a package of information written with DNA. DNA is made up of nucleotides, A, C, G, and T for short. And every three nucleotides code for one amino acid, and then the amino acids go on to form proteins. So this happens all, you know, really in a very remarkable way in terms of the actual ability to replicate, repeat. And just like a copy machine, sometimes a little line will go in or a glitch will go in. And sometimes there can be abnormal copies. Some of these can be passed down, others do not get passed down. And some of these abnormal copies, which we call mutations, can cause problems. If, for example, the a single nucleotide is miswritten, that can change that a single amino acid. And sometimes a single amino acid can change the way the protein folds, and therefore the way the protein works. But a lot of times it doesn't do anything. Sometimes even if it's a different amino nucleotide, it's the exact same amino acid that it codes for. So it is, you know, there's a lot of different ways that mutations are actually monitored for and taken care of by our bodies. So another kind of vocabulary point that I wanted to make was that we have two copies of each gene. Each copy is called an allele, and you get one from your mother and one from your father, other than the genes on the Y chromosome, which of course only men have. So if there is a mutation, or I guess I should say a trait, not a mutation necessarily, traits can be what's called autosomal dominant, and they can be autosomal recessive, and there's other things that they can be, but this is really, again, 101. So we're talking about old school, what we call Mendelian genetics, meaning Mendel with his pea plants discovering how pea plant color changed and the size of the pea pod and all of that, he figured out that each parent, both for plants as well as humans, will give one copy of each chromosome and therefore gene to each of their children. So if something is going to be expressed, either a trait or a disease, even if the other copy is normal, on the left here, we have what's called autosomal dominant. That means that just one copy is enough to cause the trait or disease. And in humans, an example would be Huntington's disease, where if there's one affected parent, they have a 50-50 chance of giving that abnormal gene to each child. So on average, 50% of their children may be affected, assuming, of course, that their partner is not somebody who also has, let's say, Huntington's disease. In the case of autosomal recessive genetics, if, let's say, both parents carry one abnormal gene and one normal gene, then each child has a 50-50 chance of getting each of those genes. So you need both copies of the gene to be abnormal in order for the disease to be expressed or the trait to be expressed. An example of this would be like cystic fibrosis or sickle cell anemia. So if both parents are what we call carriers, that means that they don't express any symptoms themselves, but they're carrying one of the abnormal copies of the gene. And then both parents would have to give their abnormal copy in order for the child to have the disorder or the trait. And so it's a 25% chance of the children developing the disease, 25% chance of the child having only the normal copies, and 50% chance of having a carrier. Now, these are very, very simple ways of thinking about genetics, this sort of 50%, 25%, because it's really much more complicated than that. Sometimes carriers can have mild symptoms. Sometimes carriers can have other traits other than just no disease or completely asymptomatic. And sometimes people can have both genes or both or a single gene in the case of it being autosomal dominant, but not fully show any of the signs or symptoms of the disorder. And we'll talk about that as well. So this is really kind of the type of genetics that, you know, we learned in college and med school and all of that. But in these past couple decades, our understanding of genetics has really, really exploded. And we're understanding that there's much more than just gene abnormalities. And most diseases don't behave in this simplified way. And Parkinson's is an example that does not behave in either the autosomal dominant or autosomal recessive in the majority of cases. So people ask me, is Parkinson's disease genetic? And I'll say, yes, but. So it isn't inherited typically in that same kind of family history pattern that I showed you with Huntington's or sickle cell disease, because about the reality in terms of what is what we are noticing is that 85% of patients who do have Parkinson's do not have a family history of Parkinson's disease. Now, of course, that may not mean that it isn't inheritable for them, because family history can be very limited by misdiagnosis. I'll have people tell me, oh, my father had a tremor, but he never got diagnosed as Parkinson's. A lot of my patients will tell me they really don't know who their family member is, either on one side, you know, usually it would be on one side, or of course, somebody could be adopted where they won't know either, may not know either side of the family. Sometimes the family members have died young, either due to accident or injury or infection. So they may not have lived long enough to develop Parkinson's disease. Sometimes people have really small families. You saw in that example of the autosomal recessive that, you know, on average, if you have four children, one in four will have the disease. Of course, that's just chances. That's not that they are going to get it. And so you can imagine if people are having more and more siblings, there will be more of an opportunity for that gene to be expressed or that probability to go through. Whereas if somebody doesn't have a lot of siblings or doesn't have, their parents don't have a lot of siblings, they're not necessarily going to know those kinds of, they're not going to have that opportunity to see that family history. Sometimes people will think they know their family members, but that there actually isn't a genetic relationship, and we call that non-paternity. And then of course, sometimes genetic mutations can occur new, or we call that de novo, meaning that it wasn't inherited by a parent. The mutation occurred in that person themselves along the way somewhere. And again, really important, most of the Parkinson's genes that we've identified are considered risk factor genes. And these don't behave the same way of autosomal dominant, autosomal recessive. What are risk factor genes? These are genes that increase the risk of somebody developing a certain condition, but either they require other genes, not other copies of that same gene, but just other genes in general, or some kind of environmental factor to create or cause the condition. So it's like a susceptibility, like somebody might be susceptible to developing Parkinson's, but there may be a lot of things that go right in their life that they don't develop Parkinson's, or conversely, other kind of sort of that perfect storm of the environment and other genes perhaps contributing. And again, these are the kinds of things that are very new, or I should say relatively new in our understanding of genetics. So we call that epigenetics. Sometimes some genes will turn on or off other genes. So that's how we are growing more understanding of the fact that it's really not as simple as it running in the family. Again, as I said, 85% of people don't have a family history. That means 15% of the time it does run in the family. We do see families where Parkinson's is happening. And then of course, a lot of families where it's not. So the likelihood that any given gene may cause either a disease or a trait or a condition is called penetrance. So the example of something that has 100% or sort of close to 100% penetrance is Huntington's disease. If people live long enough and they have that gene abnormality, they will extremely likely develop that disease. It's almost 100%. Whereas with the genes that we're dealing with, really it can range from, 5% to 30%. So let's take that worst case scenario. If the worst case scenario of a gene penetrance being 30%, that means that 70% of people who have that gene will not get Parkinson's disease. So this idea that the gene is there, but whatever was happening in the environment caused them not to develop Parkinson's. So these are sort of low penetrance genes. So what are the genes that have been associated with Parkinson's disease? And this is by no means an exhaustive list, but we want to sort of hit the highlights so that people have a sense of what's happening here. So in the top left corner here, we have very rare, but very high risk, meaning high penetrance genes. So these were genes that were identified with the old way of doing genetic testing, where they would identify families that clearly had Parkinson's running in the family, grandparents, parents, uncles, aunts, et cetera. And they identified SNCA, PINK1, Parkin, and LARC2. And these genes are very rare in the general Parkinson's population, but when they are identified, they do tend to carry a relatively high risk of that person developing Parkinson's disease. Now, please bear in mind please bear in mind, in case people have familiarity with LARC2, I'm not talking about the more common mutation of LARC2, which is the G2019S mutation. There are other LARC2 mutations that are higher risk in terms of penetrance, but much, much more rare. So please, let's not get that mixed up. So then there are the sort of second generation, if you will, of genes that were identified that are medium risk genes. and occur in an intermediate allele frequency, meaning they're more common. And that would be GBA, which we'll talk about in depth, and this particular LRRK2 mutation. So more common, but a lower risk. So if anybody has this gene mutation of LRRK2 or any of a number of gene mutations in GBA, their risk varies, but it's a medium risk. Not everybody will go on to develop Parkinson's disease. Then there are the newer genes, which I haven't even listed here, that weren't identified using families with family history of Parkinson's, but rather using this new type of genetic testing called genome-wide association studies. And that's a way of basically saying, we want to look at all the genes. We don't want to have any kind of guessing game of like, we think it might be this, or this is a family. We just want to look at about, you know, say 50,000 people who don't have Parkinson's disease and 10,000 people who do have Parkinson's disease. And we want to look at all the genes everywhere in the whole genome. And so then they start to see little, what we call risk signals. So they might increase the risk, you know, 1%, 2%, but not like really in a dramatic way, because these are really very, very low risk genes. But they're also very, very common. So how do these gene abnormalities cause Parkinson's disease? Well, what this diagram here shows on the right is a kind of network of all of the different genes that have been identified and how they may be linked to each other. And you can see that they can be clumped into parts of the cell, cell function in terms of, again, remember that genes code for proteins. So abnormal proteins causing problems in various functions of the cell. So we won't get too far into cell biology here, but the concept is that some of the genes cause problems with making dopamine, transporting dopamine, or metabolizing, meaning breaking down dopamine. Some of the genes cause problems with the mitochondria, which are the energy producing parts of the cell. Some of the genes cause problems with causing cell death or not causing cell death. And some of the genes cause problems with what's called the lysosome, which is a big part, an important part of the cell that is involved in clearing out toxic buildup within the cell. So SNCA, again, one of the oldest ones to be identified, is a gene that makes the protein alpha-synuclein, which you've probably heard about in one of our webinars or elsewhere in your reading. Alpha-synuclein, when it's abnormal, clumps together and forms Lewy bodies. And then those Lewy bodies gum up the works in the brain cells, causing death to those brain cells that make dopamine, causing Parkinson's symptoms. Now, the vast majority of people do not have this gene. So there are clearly other reasons for alpha-synuclein to become abnormal and to get clumpy. But in people who do have an abnormal SNCA gene, they do produce abnormal alpha-synuclein and then go on to have these symptoms. And this really cemented the alpha-synuclein hypothesis in terms of understanding how abnormal alpha-synuclein causes Parkinson's, because when you look at people who have these genes, the more bad copies they have of the gene, the more likely it is that they'll get Parkinson's and the younger age of onset they'll have. So it's a very clear kind of causative, abnormal alpha-synuclein causes Lewy bodies, causes Parkinson's disease. PARK2 is a different gene that makes Parkin. So because Parkin is a protein that normally helps cells recycle other proteins, abnormal Parkin causes an abnormality in protein recycling. PARK7 makes something called DJ1, which is a protein that normally protects against stress in the mitochondria. So then the mitochondria in PARK7 mutations aren't going to work as well. PINK1 and LRRK2 make a protein kinase, which normally protect the mitochondria. And GBA makes an enzyme, and an enzyme is a type of protein that creates a catalyst reaction, or excuse me, catalyzes a reaction, I should say, in the cell. And that enzyme is called glucocerebrosidase. And so when that enzyme is not working as well, then the certain cell components and proteins are not cleared out as well. And we'll get more into GBA in a bit. Oh, actually now, that's when we'll get into GBA. So how do mutations in GBA contribute to Parkinson's disease? So when there are two abnormal copies of GBA, that causes a very different condition called Gaucher's disease. And that is what we call a lysosome storage disease, which is essentially the enzyme's not working. There's a buildup of the proteins that are normally broken down by glucocerebrosidase. So there's this buildup of these proteins that become toxic, causing and affecting the liver, the bone marrow, and the brain. So enlarged spleen and liver, eye movement problems and seizures, anemia, and low platelet counts. Now, Gaucher's disease can occur in childhood. It sort of varies in terms of the severity of it. And sometimes it's fatal in infants, and sometimes it develops in childhood, and sometimes it can develop in older people as well, depending on the type of Gaucher's. But if a person only has one copy of GBA abnormal, then they're not going to get Gaucher's, but they are going to have a higher risk of Parkinson's disease. And people who do have Gaucher's disease are also at higher risk of Parkinson's disease. And why is that? Well, this abnormal glucocerebrosidase, that abnormal enzyme itself, can misfold and cause accumulation within brain cells. In addition, it can contribute to alpha-synuclein to accumulate. Again, that sort of clumping together and aggregation of alpha-synuclein. And of course, it is directly important for cell function and cell recycling because of its role in the lysosome. So really, there's three separate pathways by which abnormal glucocerebrosidase caused by this abnormal GBA gene can play a role in developing Parkinson's. And so that can manifest in different ways. So again, this is another way of putting what I've described earlier, which is that when there are two copies of Parkinson's, of an abnormal GBA, they can develop Gaucher's type 1, 2, or 3, or they can develop Gaucher's and Parkinson's disease, Gaucher's and Lewy body dementia, Gaucher's and REM sleep behavior disorder. When there's a single mutation, they can develop Parkinson's disease or Lewy body dementia or REM sleep behavior disorder. Now, the nitty gritty here, which I'm not going to get too far into, but I want to emphasize that there are more than 300 mutations that have been described in the Gaucher gene that can cause in the GBA gene that can cause Gaucher disease, as well as more than 60 mutations that have been identified that can cause Parkinson's disease when it occurs as a single, meaning only one copy. And the reason why this is relevant is that not all of these mutations are the same in terms of their risk of Parkinson's, their risk of the certain symptoms of Parkinson's, as well as what ethnic population they manifest in. There where you say, see, it says AJ, they're referring to Ashkenazi Jewish people. And so there are, they sort of broke this down. If we just sort of hone in here on the Parkinson's disease, the Ashkenazi Jewish population has these three mutations most commonly, but then, for example, there's been a Colombian study that identified a different mutation in GBA, or certain Asian populations may have completely different mutations contributing to Parkinson's disease risk. Caucasian non-Ashkenazi Jewish people also have had a lot of different things identified. Again, these all might mean different risk factors for both developing Parkinson's as well as other symptoms. And as you can see, it might also and I'm sorry, this table that I, or excuse me, chart that I brought into my slide has a typo in it. I apologize for that. But it can manifest in other ways, depending on what the gene mutation is, such as Lewy body dementia or REM sleep behavior disorder, or of course that can occur in both Parkinson's and Lewy body dementia as well. So again, keeping in mind that we really have a very low penetrance of just the single mutation GBA for Parkinson's disease. It's somewhere between 9 to 30%, depending on the gene mutation. And there is a higher penetrance at higher ages. So when you get to age 80, people who've made it there and they do have a GBA, they're going to have a 30% risk of developing Parkinson's disease, you know, in their 80s, essentially. So again, bearing in mind that penetrance refers to the proportion of people with this gene mutation who go on to develop Parkinson's disease. Conversely, GBA mutations are present in somewhere between 2 to 30% of Parkinson's patients, meaning the proportion of people with Parkinson's disease who have GBA mutations. Of course, you can imagine that varies hugely by the population that's being studied. But that being said, people who do have GBA-related Parkinson's disease do tend to have, unfortunately, an earlier age of onset, a higher risk of dementia, hallucinations, and REM sleep behavior disorder, a higher risk of a depression and anxiety, and they're more likely to have the rigid akinetic subtype than the tremor predominant Parkinson's. And again, I'm really trying to do more of a big picture view. Please bear in mind that all of these risks will vary by the mutation. So it's not just about, is there a GBA mutation? It's which GBA mutation are we talking about? So, you know, bear that in mind. What research is being done? Now, we're specifically going to just talk about GBA here. So in people who have GBA abnormalities, there are different types of treatments, some of which are established for Gaucher, which, as you remember, is the treatment that, excuse me, is the disorder when there's two copies. Unfortunately, two very important types of treatments for Gaucher do not work for Parkinson's because it doesn't get into the brain. There is a way of modulating how the original proteins turn over. So reducing the amount of glucocerebroside, meaning that protein that's supposed to get metabolized. Unfortunately, the clinical trial that studied that one of those drugs called venglustan from Sanofi was not successful. But then there are a couple of other ones that are still being looked at on this side. So trying to restore enzyme functions. Again, what we're looking at here is this is the enzyme that takes these proteins and breaks them down. And so if we can just find a way to restore that enzyme function, we will hopefully be able to reduce that buildup of that abnormal protein. So one of the treatments is gene therapy, which I'll talk about in a moment. And the other one is these small molecule chaperones, which are kind of like helpers to enzymes. So just try to kind of make this process happen even when the enzyme's not working as well. So this Ambroxol is really interesting because it's a phlegm medication. It's like a kind of like Mucinex sort of, but it's not available in the United States. And there is a clinical trial looking at using Ambroxol as a small molecule chaperone to improve the function of that enzyme in people who have GBA related Parkinson's disease. We should be expecting results early next year for this trial. And please, this is not a try this at home situation because the dosage that they're using is way higher than what would be used for actual, you know, phlegm treatment. So don't try this at home. This is a diagram of the treatment that's being studied in, I think, about 4 centers on the East Coast of this component called PR001. Which is a normal copy of the gene. Now, this is literally gene therapy. This is how can we make the gene work better? So this treatment is being infused into, I think they should have done this drawing a little bit better. It does go in as a needle into what's called the cistern, which is the cistern is where there is a fair amount of spinal fluid, so that the needle is not going into brain or brain stem, but it is going directly into spinal fluid at the base of the head here. So that is hoping to increase the function of the enzyme, reducing those abnormal proteins, so reducing toxic buildup, improving the function of the lipids and the lysosome, and reducing inflammation, reducing protein aggregation, including reducing alpha-synuclein aggregation, and hopefully trying to stop the neurodegeneration. This is a enrolling, like I said, on the East Coast, so we'll have to see how things go with this. Now, does ethnicity matter? Certain gene variants are more common in certain ethnicities. We talked about GBA, where the prevalence and penetrance are highest in the Ashkenazi population, but there's also variants in of LARC2 that are present in 26% of Ashkenazi Jewish patients and 40% of North African Berbers with Parkinson's, but not present in Nigerian Parkinson's patients. Another example is that PINK1 is higher in the Filipino population. But our ability to state, you know, what or to understand what these gene variants are in terms of how they matter in different ethnicities, not just the gene prevalence, of course, how often we'll find it, but also the penetrance or how it plays a role in the manifestation of Parkinson's disease, you know, the clinical side of things. It's really been very limited because, unfortunately, mainly these research studies have been published in the Caucasian population. So there does need to be better reach and inclusion of different ethnic groups, for sure. So a lot of my patients will ask me, should I get tested? And I always say it's a very personal decision because, you know, there can be implications. But I do want to say that there are very likely to be answers that may help eventually guide personalized medicine. Not quite yet. We're not quite there yet. We are sort of in a one size fits all world for most of what we do with Parkinson's in terms of our expectation of what will work or won't work. But I do think that, especially since our treatments are mainly symptomatic, right? They're not actually treating the underlying causes of Parkinson's disease. So hopefully genetic underpinnings of Parkinson's will inform personalized medicine. Some patients will want to participate in clinical trials such as for GBA or LARC2. We didn't get too far into the research that's happening on LARC2, but there's one that's enrolling BIB94, another one that is going to get set to enroll, I believe next year. So again, these are the most common genes you'll hear about because they're more common, but also, you know, they have that sort of moderate risk rather than being very low risk genes. So genetic testing may have increased implications if there is a family history of Parkinson's disease. So for 85% of people who don't have a family history, there may not be a genetic abnormality found. So most patients with Parkinson's will test negative even for all the genes that we do have. And genetic testing may have implications for offspring. So it is important to really think about it carefully. People often ask me, what is the risk of my family member getting Parkinson's disease? So just thinking about the general population, there is a 1% risk of a young person eventually developing Parkinson's disease. Parkinson's disease get risk increases as we get older. So in people who have made it to their 80s, their risk of developing Parkinson's disease is 3%. And this has nothing to do with, you know, genes in terms of, you know, this is just in the general population with, again, 85% of the time, no family history. So people who do have a family history in a first generation relative, meaning a parent or a sibling, their risk goes from 1% to 2%. So still there's a 98% chance that somebody who, let's say I'm talking to my patient and they have no family history and they're asking me about their kids, I tell them there's a 98% chance that their, you know, son or daughter is not going to get Parkinson's disease. However, if there's a family history, that may be different. And then having a genetic link may confer a higher risk. So example, that very rare gene abnormality in SNCA, it is autosomal dominant. So it is up to a 50% risk of that person passing their one, that abnormal gene to one of their, each one of their children, right? And again, remember when we say 50%, we're talking probability. So it doesn't, you know, even though those diagrams made it seem that, you know, only one of the two children or only, you know, one of the four for autosomal recessive, but reality is, you know, it's like flipping a coin, right? You can envision a normal coin coming up tails five times in a row. That can happen, right? So, 50-50 doesn't necessarily exactly mean that only half of the children will get it, just that each child has an independent 50% risk. And then LRRK2, again, as I said, is autosomal dominant, but only 30% penetrant. And again, that differs depending on which mutation we're talking about. But let's talking about the common mutation, there would be a 15% risk. So for example, if I'm speaking to the person sitting in front of me, they have LRRK2, they don't know if their children have a LRRK2 abnormality or not. There's a 50-50% chance they get the LRRK2. And then there's a 30% chance times half. So a 15% chance that they will go on to develop Parkinson's disease. Whereas then, of course, if they do get tested, then it would be either a 1% risk or a 30% risk. And of course, this is assuming that it's only one family, only one parent who's carrying this abnormal gene. If somebody who has Parkinson's disease and does have LRRK2 happens to marry somebody who's a LRRK2 carrier and doesn't happen to have Parkinson's disease, you know, then their child, has a 100% chance. Well, because they could still have, then they'll have a 75% chance of getting one abnormal copy, and then 75 times 30%, right? So was that 22.5, something like that. So then there are the autosomal recessive mutations like Parkin, so that would confer up to a 25% risk. And then there are the genetic risk factors, which increase the risk quite variably. So really, if people really wanna know the answer to that question, genetic testing can help for that. But very important to bear in mind that even if I'm repeating myself, but I'm doing it on purpose. Even if a family member tests positive for, let's say, LRRK2 or GBA, it does not mean they are going to get Parkinson's disease. So should my family member get tested for Parkinson's disease is the question I get asked a lot. Excuse me, I'm going to take a sip of water. Thank you. So what I say is, what is this family member going to do with this information? You know them best. Is this something that's going to be helpful to them or not? Some of my patients' family members are going to be interested in research studies or clinical trials. Some will be more motivated to improve their lifestyle factors such as diet and exercise, which they should be doing anyway, which I'll talk about in the next slide, or the one after that, I should say. But I could envision somebody saying, you know what, I'm really going to take this seriously, because I frankly believe that a lot of these things with lifestyle, which we will discuss in the next slide over, it really matters how long people have been doing it. The decisions that a 20-year-old, a 30-year-old, a 40-year-old is making has a big impact on whether or not they're going to get a disease in their 60s and 70s. So I think a lot of 20 and 30-year-olds don't necessarily think that way. So maybe it would be helpful, you know, even if they already know what they're supposed to do, maybe it would motivate them to actually do it. Some family members might be too anxious. It might not be helpful to have that information. So it's really important for it to be a very personal decision. Also, I will say that some people, you know, I think what I would do is I would just put a Google alert, right? Like, tell me when new information is coming out about GBA. You know, maybe there's not something that I need to take today, but what if, you know, 10 years from now, there is a treatment that I'm supposed to take to prevent myself from getting Parkinson's disease. So that's the concept, is what's going to happen over these next, you know, 5 to 10 years, I think may really inform whether somebody should have their family member tested. And again, this is really assuming that the person themselves has the gene abnormality. So I would generally say start with, you know, the actual person with Parkinson's getting tested. And then if there's an abnormality, then the family member should consider it. But if there's no abnormality in the person who already has Parkinson's, then really that family member just has that, you know, 2% risk as I described earlier. So how can we predict who will get Parkinson's disease? So for example, a family member has tested positive for GBA and they want to know, am I going to get Parkinson's or am I going to be in that lucky 70 or 80% of people who won't get Parkinson's? So there's this really cool predict score with a G instead of a C, and it's an equation, and it is Parkinson's risk, so PR, is equal to the sum of E, D, and I times G and times T. So E stands for environmental factors. D stands for DNA, meaning genetic considerations. I is initiation of tissue response, meaning subtle things that are sort of pointing towards this person going on to develop an abnormal alpha-synuclein disorder or an abnormal tau disorder. G is gender and T is time. So G and T are the easy ones. T is literally how old they are. G is if they are male, there's a very slightly increased risk compared to a female. But let's get a little bit more detail about environmental factors. So the things that we have identified that put an increased risk are exposures to pesticides, welding, meaning manganese exposure, head trauma. And again, I shouldn't say again, because this might be the first time you're hearing it. Head trauma is really about how often is the head getting hit. So that's why when we look at, for example, the football players and their risk of chronic traumatic encephalopathy or CTE, which is different from Parkinson's disease, but can manifest with Parkinson's-like symptoms. People who have the football players who were professional had a higher risk than college level players who had a higher risk than high school level players, because it's the number of hits that they got in their lifetime, even if it was a subconcussive hit, meaning even if they just got hit and they didn't feel anything bad, they, you know, maybe they saw stars for like a brief moment and then nothing, they're totally fine. It still counts. It's really very accumulative. Whereas a single, let's say, car accident, you know, and like a whiplash injury, probably not going to confer a huge risk. So then there is chronic infection, such as H. pylori or other viruses or bacteria, a history of encephalitis, chronic constipation, and a reduced sense of smell are considered environmental factors. Although I would sort of think of them as already initiation of tissue response, but in this paper, they identified that as E. And each of those factors adds a certain number of points to that scoring system. And again, this might emphasize that there might be lifestyle choices that a person could make if they're young enough and, you know, might be at risk and might decide, okay, well, maybe I don't want to go into welding, or I'm not going to, you know, I decided I'm not going to become a boxer because I have this genetic risk factor. I'm sort of stretching, I think, the imagination there, but that's just an example. There are other environmental factors that have been identified with a risk of developing Parkinson's, but I believe they're just too widespread to play a role in the predict score because, for example, air pollution, water pollution, I think these are things that we're all ubiquitously exposed to. So this may not be as much of a individual risk factor. The genetic factors that they identified are the ones that we've discussed already, as well as other risk loci, as well as just a family history of Parkinson's disease. And again, bear in mind, we're really talking about first degree relatives, parents, siblings, or technically children as well. But, you know, some people will ask me, well, my, you know, grandmother's sister had Parkinson's disease. Well, you know, that's like a third degree relative. Like really, that really doesn't confer much risk. So I wouldn't worry about grandparents or, you know, grandchildren, unless it is running in the family, like in those sort of rare cases that it does run in the family. That I score, the initiation of tissue response, when somebody has evidence of REM sleep behavior disorder, which we have talked about in some of our other lectures, meaning the dream enactment behavior, kicking and punching during dreams, that is sort of a sign of brewing Parkinson's disease already. And what's interesting is that protective factors were subtracted from the score. So if somebody's had regular exercise for more than 20 years, they drink more than 2 cups of coffee a day, certain genetic risk factors, they actually caused a subtraction rather than a addition in the scoring. I do have to say that smoking is associated with a reduced risk of developing Parkinson's, but please don't smoke. Don't tell your kids to smoke. On the whole, it's obviously very bad for us. So that is not a recommendation there. So what should my family do to prevent Parkinson's disease? So again, let's assume somebody has a genetic risk factor or a strong family history and their family member either does or doesn't have genetic testing done. What are they going to do with this information? So at this time, there's no specific treatment to prevent Parkinson's disease, but lifestyle does appear to play a big role. So the mind diet has been shown to be associated with a lower risk of developing Parkinson's disease or pushing it to a later age of onset. Higher frequency of vigorous physical exercise is also associated with a lower risk of developing Parkinson's. I tend to recommend to my patients to avoid unnecessary antibiotics, such as in food to maintain a healthy microbiome, but we don't have data on, oh, go take such and such probiotic. And air and water pollution do appear to play a role. So advocacy may, you know, be important, which there I put in a plug there for the endingpd.org Give a Dime campaign. So now let's say you've decided you do want to get tested, all this being said. So this is my final slide. This is the most common question. How do we do it? So one of the ways that I like to recommend is the PD generation study, because it is a observational study, whether or not you've ever been tested before, whether or not you have a family history. It's basically anybody and everybody who has Parkinson's disease is a candidate for this study. It's research, but it's not a trial. There's nothing experimental happening. And what's nice is they're doing it virtually, so you don't have to go anywhere. And you can get information from the Parkinson Foundation website, parkinson.org/PDgeneration. And it does include eight genes that are being tested, including multiple mutations within GBA and LARC2. They are doing basically history and an exam. And then they do genetic counseling, which is really nice because then it's all built in. It's all free of charge. And what this study is trying to do is establish connections between the genotype and the phenotype, meaning the genetic information and the particular symptoms that somebody has. And I think this is a really great opportunity. And it's important for us to push this knowledge forward, so we're not having these isolated people getting tested without us sort of having a broader sense of what does it all mean. So I do encourage people to consider participating in that study. Invitae is a genetic company that tests for 26 genes, including 19 variants of the GBA gene. And that one does offer sponsored testing and counseling, meaning it's privately paid for. And again, you can go to invitae.com or ask your provider about that. Michael J. Fox is still running his foundation is still running the Parkinson's Progression Markers Initiative, the PPMI, and they are doing some genetic testing with that. But I wouldn't encourage people to do 23andMe because they're really only looking at one variant of GBA and one variant of LRRK2. So I think it's more limited. I mean, so many people are going to test negative, but I think there's more that we need to know. I would say the top two are the best options, PD generation and Invitae. I'm going to stop there and see if people have questions for me.
This is an interesting question. Do animals like primates get PD?
I don't believe they have natural PD, but there are non-human primate models of Parkinson's where they create a lesion to make them look like they've got Parkinson's like symptoms, but I don't think it occurs naturally. Natalie, you can correct me if I'm wrong. Dr. Diaz, I should say.
That's okay. No, I'm with you on that.
Yeah. That's a really good question.
Yeah.
Is it possible to get the list of trials you spoke of? Yes, we can do that. We can put that on the website with this link. Yeah. I also, if people are interested in clinical trials or research like observational research, I always recommend clinicaltrials.gov. Again, it's .gov. That's the important one. Clinicaltrials.gov, where you can search for clinical trials through putting in Parkinson's disease and then hitting recruiting or soon to be recruiting. And then you can narrow it down to where you're interested in participating. So usually I just look in California. And then the other good way to get involved with clinical trials is the Fox Trial Finder, which is on the Michael J. Fox website, which connects people to potential clinical trials, which is nice because then it's sort of a pool of potential participants that, you know, if a clinical trial is going to enroll in the future, you know, they can sort of go back and see if there's people who've previously been interested. The Fox Trial Finder is not in and of itself a clinical trial. So if you do agree to give your information to Fox Trial Finder, all you are consenting to is permission to be contacted. That's all it is. I again wanted to emphasize that there's a difference between an observational study and clinical trials. So I don't believe as of right now that there's any clinical trials for people who have a particular gene but don't have Parkinson's disease. I think the ones that are enrolling are mainly observational studies or registries to, you know, evaluate people who have the gene but not the disease. Dr. Diaz, can you think of any other questions that you get asked frequently on this topic?
No, I think you did. That was a great talk, Melita. I think you covered. I think the most common question we always get is, you know, a parent who's had it or a grandparent, and what is my risk? I think you did a good job there sort of explaining all the different factors that go into sort of risk. It's not a simple one, right? As you mentioned, for most people, it's not a direct genetic sort of risk. It's a complex a look at these factors unless there is a strong family history or somebody who's young, as you mentioned. Mm-hmm. That's probably the most common question that we get. And then about genetic testing, right? Which we always have to be careful because, as you mentioned, people will find ways to do it. And you always have to be careful because the information that you get sometimes from some of these places is not, the way we look at things.
I remember a patient of mine who had just randomly gotten genetic testing done for Alzheimer's disease, and she tested positive, and she was so distraught that she literally started like researching Oregon's Right to Die movement. Like, she was just terrified. And I said, whoa, slow down. Like, just because you have a gene risk factor does not mean you are going to get this disease. You have to kind of take things in context. So I think it is kind of scary when people don't have the context, because, you know, again, you know, actually the majority of what we see is people who don't have the gene, but they do have the disease. So it's very important people not to think of the gene as getting tested for Parkinson's disease. And I think the other thing that you brought up that I wanted to emphasize was that it is probably much more relevant for a young onset person that they really should consider genetic testing. And when we say young onset, we mean like 45 and younger. No offense to our young at heart 50-year-old patients, but really it's the... we draw a strong line there. And the other thing I wanted to say was that what's interesting about the genetics and how the genetics have informed our development of further treatments for Parkinson's is that there's some reason to believe that even when people don't have a specific gene abnormality, treating the gene products may be playing a role. So for example, with LRRK2, even people who don't have a gene abnormality in LRRK2, but they have Parkinson's disease, they've been shown to have excess activity of LRRK2. So that's why these LRRK2 inhibitors are being tested, not just in people who have LRRK2 gene abnormalities, but also in people who don't have LRRK2 gene abnormalities. So I think it's really relevant to everybody, even without a family history, because as we said, 85% of people do not have a family history. We have a great question about where to find a description of the MIND diet. And I'll just give a brief spiel on that. That's emphasizing eating green leafy vegetables, other vegetables, nuts and berries, beans and other legumes, olive oil, fish and poultry, and whole grains. Technically, the MIND diet also includes a glass of wine. Red wine, I should say. I'm not a huge fan of that in terms of adding it to somebody who has Parkinson's disease, but I mention it because it's technically part of the MIND diet. More importantly, the MIND diet requests people or suggests that people restrict their intake of sweets, fried food, processed food, red meat, cheese, and butter, and probably restricting dairy in general. So the concept of the MIND diet is that you don't have to be perfect, but anything closer to the MIND diet than the standard American diet is a step in the right direction. And then the question was, will it be possible to overcome the gene abnormalities? And the short answer is yes, of course, because we know that, as I said, you know, let's say 70, 80% of people who have these gene abnormalities do not get Parkinson's disease. That means they are doing something either intentionally or unintentionally that has allowed them to overcome those gene abnormalities. And I guess if the question is, if somebody already has Parkinson's disease, can they overcome the gene abnormality? Probably not at that point, but again, something like the gene therapy that's being developed for people with the GBA gene abnormalities, that is a theoretical way that one might be able to in the future overcome the gene abnormalities. But that is sort of in a very early state of research right now. So no promises yet on that one.
Dr. P, we do have a few questions on the Q Q&A. I'm not sure. I know it's 1 o'clock already. Do you want to answer a few more questions, or?
I'll just say that there is not any charge for the PD generation, which is Parkinson.org, and it's Parkinson.org, not Parkinson's, for the Parkinson Foundation. And Invitae is also doing sponsored testing, meaning no cost. The other question of environmental things like paraquat, et cetera, sort of outside of the scope of today's talk, but certainly I think if you have more interest, check out endingpd.org, because they have a lot about environmental causes in their book and website. This is a book written by Michael Okun, Bass Blom, and two other very well-regarded Parkinson's researchers. If you think you want a child tested, is there a best age to do so? I wouldn't test a child per se, but I'm assuming you meant adult child. That's a personal question. I think it would sort of vary depending on what the person's genetic abnormality is. But I would think, in their 20s, 30s, 40s is reasonable. Even older is also reasonable. There's no right or wrong age other than not under 18. That's all I would say. All right. Thank you guys so much. I think let's wrap it up there.
Thank you very much. I know that was like a lot of information, but very useful information. Definitely it opens up the conversation between families and loved ones. Talk about genetic testing, if it is in your family or if you do have a family history of Parkinson's disease. And that is exactly why we do have this webinar, is because it's good to open this conversation. So thank you very much, everyone, for joining us today. We will see you back next month for another webinar on everything Parkinson. Happy holidays, everyone. Thank you so much, Dr. Petrossian and Dr. Diaz, for being here with us today. Happy New Year, everyone.